Hello, hello! Welcome to the World Touring Car Championship 2016. This time, finally, we are at a gloriously sunny Vila Real circuit in Portugal, ready ahead for FP1s just about to happen. We had testing yesterday, and we saw very quick times from the Honda boys. Also, Ivan Muller was up there. Hugo Valente was up there as well. It threw out all sorts of things at these drivers. This is a tricky, tricky circuit. Now, behind me, we have Robert Dahlgren, and he is a brand newbie to, well, in fact, he's not a brand newbie to WTCC, but he is a newbie this time, this year. And I'm just going to grab Frederik Valén, who's going to tell me a little bit more about your weekend ahead. You've learned a few things yesterday. I think Robert struggled a little bit with the car, but it's a brand new circuit for you guys. What are you learning?
Yeah, definitely it's a brand new circuit, and it's a city circuit, which is always tricky. Finally, we have the weather on our side. It's dry for once, so it's really good. And like you said, Robert is learning both the car and the track, and this is a hard track to learn as well. So
when I spoke to Ted earlier, he was really excited about this track. He said it's actually not that dissimilar to sort of what the Nürburgring was throwing at them.
No, it's a lot similar. It's very hard. And if you do a mistake, you're in the wall for certain. So step by step, we're learning the track and going faster and faster, and we will see what happens today.
It's nice to see Robert back in the WTCC. We have seen him over the years. He's been back and forth, hasn't he, with Volvo. Do we now see him for the rest of the season? Is he replacing Frederik for the rest of the duration, or will we see both of them in?
I won't answer that yet. We will see. At the moment, Robert has been part of the development program the whole time, and now he finally has the chance to do it in a race, and we will see what happens the next couple of races.
Great. Well, we'll look forward to seeing how he gets on. Let's head over to FP1.
Thank you, Al. Thank you, Frederik. And welcome back to Robert Dahlgren. Good morning, everybody. Martin Haven and alongside me, Harry Folkard. And Harry, for the first time, we've been able to come away on a World Touring Car weekend without our waders, which is just a pleasant relief.
Yeah, pretty unusual, isn't it? It's been more like British Touring Car weather than World Touring Cars, what we're used to seeing, even raining in Africa.
Yes. Yeah. That. Now then, just been notified that Daniel Nagy will not be allowed to take part in the first free practice session. His car was in its constituent parts yesterday, an engine and a chassis, but they had not at any stage been put together. They were put together overnight. See lots of fans here for Thiago Monteiro, and Thiago, as ever, will have a lot of home support. This was not a happy race meeting for him last year. He ended up in a massive three-car pileup at the roundabout, just after the start, and ended up going to hospital, but he was okay, and he will be hoping for a little bit better fortune here. I think perhaps races in Portugal owe him now. He has done enough of them, not really had an awful lot of rub of the green, obviously, and red, being the Portuguese flag colours. So Norbert Nagy was due to partake of his first time session in World Touring Cars, the second Sengo Motorsport Honda, but the 17-year-old will not go out in free practice one, and I'm assuming that's because the car has not been fully scrutinised by our officials.
It's a new car to the championship as well, I think, isn't it? It's his first time out.
So. Yeah, but it is a full season entry, so he's not just sort of turned up by surprise, but clearly the car was not quite ready, hasn't been scrutinised, and as a result will go out, hopefully in FP2. And it's a baptism of fire, Harry. This is not a track that you've been to before, but it is a very unusual street circuit. We sort of, you know, you see street circuit, everybody goes, oh, yeah, Monaco, yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, average speed, 90 miles an hour. Here, the average speed is getting on for about 130 miles an hour, and that's with a first gear chicane, a second gear chicane, and a roundabout. It is properly, scarily fast out around normal urban streets, not big, wide boulevard, but lots of normal two-lane roads. So this is, it's bumpy, it's fast, and I can see exactly why they say it's a bit like the Nürburgring. Okay, a lot shorter and with far fewer trees surrounding you, but yeah.
It's an old school, hardcore street circuit, isn't it? And if you get it wrong, it's gonna really, really bite you because you're going very, very quick. And as you say, there's a lot of bumps as well around here, which is because it is genuinely used as a proper road where, you know, the Monacos of this world are basically a race circuit, which you can drive on nowadays.
Exactly right. The cars filing out as they head around a circuit that has been in various guises used since 1931, and in those days, of course, it would have been like all roads, it would have been just dirt and stones, and 1930s cars, you can imagine, would have been quite a handful on the loose. It would have been as much a rally as a race, definitely in terms of traction. And then they raced on it in tarmac form. It was disused for a while. They started bike racing again on it in the late 70s, early 80s, and raced motorcycles here. And when you look at this track, you'll be going, really? And that was on the full-length circuit. We're using about half of the original Villarreal circuit. It used to cross the gorge that runs through the middle of town, which is the Douro River, which is the river that leads all the way down to Porto. And this is the massive mountainous wine-growing region of Portugal, in the north of Portugal where we are, Villarreal, the royal city. And the royal family would have left the heat of Lisbon or Porto and come up into the mountains for the cool mountain air during the summer to get away from, well, predominantly the smell of the cities in far-flung times. But again, as you can see, lined with barriers, and that reduces visibility enormously, doesn't it? You know, the driver's eye line will be below the line of the barriers. We can see what they're looking into, but they don't. So a lot of this will be driven blind and in total faith of the flag signals to make sure that if something happens in front of you, then you don't run into it at full tilt.
Yeah, you're absolutely relying on the marshals doing their job, which normally they're really good at with street circuits, but it is 100% their responsibility to make sure that you're aware if somebody does go off. But sometimes if it's, you know, in racing conditions, it's too quick. Someone can stack it three cars ahead, and by the time the marshals even found out, you're into them. So,
yeah,
difficult one.
Well, here we're going down to the second chicane. This is down at turn 11. And again, you can see, you know, it's a very normal residential road. And the cars are really, really motoring on. As they start to pick up speed in free practice, you'll see just how quick some of the top speeds are. Now, because we've had a little alteration to the circuit, corner six, which was the first sort of T-junction chicane-y thing we saw, was a first gear corner and is now more of a second, maybe even a grab of a third gear corner if it rubbers up nicely. All the circuit records are now set to be re-established. In the first testing session yesterday, cars were within a tenth of last year's qualifying record, so it's about 2.5, 3 seconds, maybe a lap quicker than it was before. Well, here is the Zengo Motorsport garage, and there is car number 99, and that is the car of Daniel Nagy. Brother Norbert races in the European Touring Car Cup. They are here this weekend, and ETCC having their first ever street race, and that is going to be quite an eye-opener for them, because it's a very, very demanding place, this. Again, as you watch Nicky Katzberg, who had a massive high-speed shunt last year, now you can start to see, even on the first flying lap, how much the cars are moving around. They are very quick here.
Yeah, it's kind of Macau-esque, isn't it?
Yeah.
The undulation, the way the track rises and falls into the valley, it's a lot of high-speed corners, and it's particularly narrow as well, you know, it's very tight.
Yeah. And with these things, there is no substitute for confidence. Lada with 70 kilos of success ballast, and they were joking that the car has now got a NASCAR-style stagger because it's all in a ballast box by the right-hand front door. So they've loaded all the ballast onto what is the inside on this clockwise circuit to try and make sure that it has as little an effect on the car as possible. But the more you're having to start and stop, and the more you're having to twist and turn, the harder it'll be.
It's a huge huge difference as well, where you do load the weight into a car. Further forward, it kind of has more effect, takes more out of the tires, but gives you more nose, obviously. And further back makes the car a little bit more relaxed and a bit slower. It makes it more like a pendulum effect, so when it does start to break away, it's a lot slower, but also probably a little bit easier to catch. So somewhere tight and twisty like this, you do want it over the front, and where tire degradation is not really a major issue, that's why they'll have gone over that front inside wheel as well, to keep the weight over the inside corner.
So that little chicane we just came through, turns 19 and 20, 21, 22, and then sweeping around after corner 23. Again, lots of crests and brows, a little dip there you see as you come over the top, and then a little bumpy, ripply braking area down into this roundabout. And without the rain, does really quite remind me of the Birmingham Super Prix, just because it is, you know, in a built-up area. Monaco, obviously, we understand, is very, very different, and a very different looking city, is that the word? I suppose it sort of is, or principality, whatever, to most other street circuits. But this is definitely not, you know, a US grid where, if you think of places like Long Beach, it's all, you know, 90 degree intersections, and we don't have that here. This is a much more organic town that's grown up over the years, and higgledy-piggledy roads have been sort of added as and when, you know, in a very European style, rather than laid out on a grid and created from scratch. When the town was here long before cars were.
Yeah, you can see that with the architecture around the place as well. It's, you know, you can see it's all kind of popped up in and around, and it is very much, like I said, it's an old school street circuit. It is racing on the streets as opposed to a racetrack which has been built around a city.
Nice little festival in town as well. Yesterday was Feast de Saint Joao, Saint Jean, which is a big European feast day, and had a kind of throw a big party around the weekend here. Just outside the track, up the hill, is the centre of the old city. Bands playing and everybody out eating in the streets and enjoying themselves in some very nice evening sunshine.
Well, hopefully you're right on the edge there. Do you see that little bit of oversteer and a little bit of opposite lock he had to put in there?
Lada behind shot the chicane, just didn't get it stopped. And, you know, there's a perennial problem. You're always pushing to the limit, Harry, and there is nowhere to go here if you get it wrong.
No, you're straight. Well, you're all right in the chicane if you can outbrake yourself slightly, but Norby's backed off there a little bit.
Yeah, and I think maybe he was finding turbulence from Rob was just unsettling his car a little too much.
He actually caught him quite a lot there in both those first two sectors, so perhaps Rob was almost slowing him down slightly.
The Honda's going very quickly. Thiago has gone fastest. Rob quicker than him now. Nicky Katzberg, who was the Lada that shot the chicane, or was it Gabrielli? Maybe it was Gabrielli. Nicky Katzberg's just gone third, fourth quickest. Ted Bjerk popped to the top of the pile. So the deal with Dahlgren... So Robert Dahlgren, let's talk about Robert very quickly. I'm sure we'll find him in a minute as Gabrielli continues on another quick lap. Gabrielli feeling no pain this morning. He was in very, very good form, as ever. It's not too many... Gabrielli's not really hard to read, is he? When he's happy, you can tell. When he's not happy, you don't have to go looking very hard.
He has that Italian flair, doesn't he?
So, on board with Robert Dahlgren then in the Volvo. Ted Bjerk, his teammate, is fastest. Robert, sixth quickest. Okay, so he's not driven this car before. Fredrik Ekblom, I'm assuming now that that Sign Racing Polestar have got a third chassis, because Fredrik, we understand, is going to do non-racing development work, particularly on the car. Robert Dahlgren is currently contending the Swedish Touring Car Championship. And his campaign, I don't think this is a clashing weekend, but there is at least one clashing weekend, and World Touring Cars will take precedence. Robert, with experience of the championship, with experience of some of the circuits, none that he's going to go to. Oh, I don't know. Did they go to Shanghai? Can't remember, with the C30. But he raced here with Polestar with the C30, and it would be a very great surprise not to see him in the team next year, when we understand they're going to try and expand, or their intention is to expand to a three-car factory team, and very likely two privateer cars as well.
Yeah, when was Dahlgren's last year in World Touring Car? Would it have been 2011?
Yeah. It doesn't seem that long ago since the Volvo C30, but yes, it probably was.
Yeah, I think it was certainly the previous era of the regulation, wasn't it? And it was. 10 was when they ran the green and white livery, and then I think 11 was when they went blue.
You've got a good memory, H, you really have. I couldn't even remember they had a green and white livery, but you're absolutely right, they did. Norbert Mikkel is fastest for Honda. Ivar Muller's second quickest. And I was being asked yesterday, what did you say in Moscow when Citroën was slow? I said, circuit doesn't suit them. That's what we want in touring cars. We don't want the same car to be quick everywhere. We want them to go to circuits where there are not any differences between the cars. So, Norbert Mikkel is fastest of all. Ivan Muller second, Rob Huff third. Hugo Valente fourth quickest for the Lada. So he's the best of the Ladas at the moment. They're going to have to sort of get used to that now, aren't they, with the extra success balance. They've not had that much weight in the car before. So it's a sort of different engineering prospect to try and mitigate that weight against the car's performance. Well, there's the revised chicane at turn 6. Then you go left through 7. Fourth, fifth. This is very, very quick. Now, actually, Rob's had a little bit of a feather of the throttle there. Went out in the safety car last year around the track, and that straight, you are just absolutely barreling down there towards a blind brow, and you can see the Armco bending off in front of you and go, okay, this is quite quick. Especially for pedestrians like me. Harry, you'd be fine with it, but when you're a pedestrian like me, it's very different.
But it takes a bit of learning this circuit as well, because it is a long circuit as well. And as you said, there's a lot of blind crests and bumps that you need to know where they are, and surface changes as well. We saw that was a fairly fundamental difference when we went to Morocco. It was a key player in how the cars were handling. The Honda dealt with that really well. And
Ivan, do not go out there on the dirt. I mean, he was almost in someone's driveway there.
Yeah, I think, is that Lopez? Yeah,
oh, yeah, Lopez. It was Lopez.
He, lucky boy there, I thought he was going to be in the wall.
I did too.
You don't normally get away with chucking up that much dirt and dust and surviving on a street circuit.
Yeah, normally you'd be bouncing across the grass and you'd be going, oh, that was a close one. I tell you what, I bet he's got eyes like dinner plates.
Yeah. Not want to do that one again.
You would not. That's it. That's your lucky break.
Yeah.
Now, but again, look how much he's having to move the car around. You know, this shouldn't really be a circuit that suits it. It's got stunning traction, which is their big, big bonus here, particularly out of the chicanes, out of the roundabout. The high-speed stuff here, it's got great stability, and that really helps. But the medium stuff, where you're really having to rotate the car, you saw how indelicate he was having to be with it, how hard he was having to work it to get it to rotate.
Here we go, I think this is... Oh, no.
All right. Well, that's just a little lock-up and a brush with the barriers. That is the chicane that protects the pit lane exit, but I'd like to see that moment from Lopez again, because how he got away without parking it in somebody's garden, I don't know.
Yeah, that was Huffy, who's on... He's just set the fastest first sector of anyone by under 2 tenths, but...
Huff Daddy, Huff Mummy have been here as well, I believe, all week in Porto, enjoying a little bit of pre-race weekend sunshine. And for those of you who live anywhere in Europe, actually, I'm sure all of you will understand that sentiment.
Yeah, going back to what you were saying about the Citroën Martin, it's a heavy car at the moment because of all the success ballast, but as we know, it handles really well in high speed, medium speed corners, but it looks a little bit sedate and a little bit clumsy around the tighter, twisty sections of this circuit.
I was trying to remember yesterday, talking about Huffy goes quicker again, talking about European Touring Car Cup and the fact that the ETCC is racing on a street circuit for the first time in its current iteration, then trying to figure when was the last time European Touring Cars raced on the street circuit. And the one I always think of is the old circuit at Brno, which we've driven around many times, regaling ourselves with delights of just imagine driving a TWR XJS through here, going, oh my lord. But certainly that was a big feature. I don't know, may have been others, I'm not sure. I can't think when else though. So if you can always tweet us answers on a postcard, usual stuff. So at the moment we've got Honda from Huff, Honda from Mikulicz, Lopez in the get out of jail card. Here he is. Look at how much it's up on its toes, that car.
Yeah, it looks almost too long, doesn't it?
For a fantasy bar, that is a bar this time. Well, it is. It's a longer chassis than either of its or any of its rivals. Yeah, it's a long four-door, three-box saloon, and it is long and stable. Citroën team, I'm sure, will be doing their very best, just as Lada are, just as Honda are. Honda with the lighter of the three cars at the moment, not as light as Volvo, but with less weight on them for the first time this year than Lada, benefiting from that. But the shorter the wheelbase, basically, the easier the car spins or turns, and the longer, stabler Citroën is definitely not enjoying itself so much around here. And that just means the driver has to work it in a different way. And that's something that a lot of drivers do, Harry, though, is change their driving style a little bit for the nature of the car and the nature of the circuit. And that's all part of the game, isn't it?
Absolutely. And some cars have certain characteristics. You know, we always saw in the previous era, the Chevrolet was like the Citroën is now, you know, very, very good at high to medium speed stuff. It could kind of alter its line mid-corner. And fantastic and a very, very good thing in most situations. But yeah, the rarity of a street circuit like this, it's kind of, it's not exactly what you want. But yeah, they'll have done as much as they can to negotiate those problems. But we just heard before that Nagy, who wasn't allowed to start the session, has had a throttle sensor problem, so he's going to be out later on in the session, apparently.
All right, well, we'll wait and see what that was. Certainly we could see laptops plugged in and lots of people staring intently at them, which usually means the thing won't start.
It's also, you don't want the, if there's any question over the throttle sensor,
oh dear Lord, yes,
yeah, it's all fly by wire, and if something's not quite meeting up, and you don't want that to be stuck open when you need to be slowing it down.
I mean, and the other thing is, you know, everything that is so closely governed by the electronics is he won't have access to any of the proper maps, so he'll have all the turbo boost or none at all, or, you know, all the traction or none at all, or no throttle whatsoever, or, you know, so it either won't start or it won't run properly, or, and exactly as you say, you can't have anything, you know, catching you out here, because there's enough for the poor kid to learn as it is. Yeah, everybody else has already done a 30-minute session yesterday. They'll do this 30-minute session. So if he doesn't get out until free practice two, he's got qualifying looming up in front of him on a street circuit he's never driven at, in a car he's never driven, with everybody else whistling by his ears on either side. You know, that is a big baptism of fire for a 30-year-old racing driver with experience, never mind a 17-year-old kid.
I wonder if his brother in ETCC is older or younger.
Norbert's older, not much older, but he is a little older.
So is there a bit of favouritism going on there? The younger son gets to race in wheelchair and car?
Well, I don't know. I'm not quite sure. It's one of those Zoltan Zengo deals. So sounds as though Nagy's car is now ready to go. So we will see for the second time, or for the first time, a second green and grey Zengo Motorsport Honda. Looking here at Mehdi Banani. Banani will go in Mach 3 for Citroën. Tom Chilton did the last one, Mehdi is doing this one. I wonder whether they're now going to flip-flop, turn and turn about, because clearly Tom proved in the one in Moscow that he's got the pace and the ability to do it. But at the beginning of the season, they went with Mehdi because he was the only non-factory Citroën driver who had ever driven a Citroën before the start of the season. So they thought, well, do you know what? Let's make our third guy a guy who knows what the car does. And you definitely can't argue with that. Nicky Katzberg just in front of him. Katzberg, 10th place in the Lada. Ooh! See, now that's one of the issues here as well for Tom Chilton there on a quickie. And luckily, either Ivan saw him coming or the radio of the team was saying, Tom's behind you, look out, and so he pulled over. But there wasn't an awful lot of room to pull over, was there?
Well, Midgelitz is obviously on a bit of a stormer there, look at that.
Norby is, he's
3.5 tenths in sector one ahead of the fastest lap, 7 tenths ahead of the second in second two, sector two fastest lap. But we saw before, Huffy seemed to be on a bit of one the previous lap. He's now in the pits, so I wonder if Norbitz has been in the pits and swap for some new tyres.
Yeah, it sounds like Norby is on a fresh tyre run. Huffy was as well, clearly, but he got 3 or 4 consecutive laps, which could be very encouraging for qualifying. Down into the roundabout. And see, this is probably a little higher than the driver's eye, isn't it? Because we're just above window, well, we're sort of just about above window level, so actually maybe about driver's eye line.
Yeah, that almost a second faster than the previous fastest lap. It's got to be a new tyre run.
Very, very quick. Let's see what his next lap is. Well, there goes Daniel Nagy. Good luck, sunshine. 17 years old. And well done also to the boys at Zengo. There's Zoltan Zengo, the team boss. Well done to the boys at Zengo. Yesterday they had a chassis, which they've had all season, and an engine on a pallet. And they combined the two overnight. John Philippi goes through the chicane as Mehdi Banani straight lines it. John Philippi looking quite busy as well, his car. At the moment he's 16th, ahead of Grégoire de Moustier and behind Ferenc Fischer. And Fischer in the other of the Zengo Motorsport cars down there in 15th place. I'm being quietly impressed by him. He was very quick indeed in Russia in all conditions. And he's really developing very nicely. Given his real paucity of experience and his youth, Zoltan Zengo not only lost Norbert Michelitz last year when he went to the Castrol Honda team for this year. But also Gergely, the most experienced of the Zengo engineers, who was Norby's engineer for 3 or 4 years, he is now working at Castrol Honda, and a couple of the other technicians have moved over as well. And I was talking to Zoltan Weir in Moscow, and he said, you know, that's fine. It's a shame to lose lots of experience all in one go, he said, but now I've hired young engineers like we started with when Gergely started here. He was a young engineer in his first major job. And so now we've hired another couple of young engineers. We've got young drivers, we've got young mechanics. It is, you know, a young family. And so he's quite happy to be a kind of training ground for these all young Hungarians.
It's good to have a bit of young hunger as well. Mm. Younger Hungarian.
No, young hungry hunger, yeah, there we go. Young Magyar, strictly, as opposed to Hungar, but we'll go with that. It absolutely is, because they're all keen to learn. You know, the one slight problem is that they don't have experience. And Daniel here, I have to say, I really, really don't envy him.
It looks like there's an issue there.
Yeah, that really does look like there's an issue there, because, you know, all right, he's not quite sure where he's going, but he would be going quicker than this. So I think the car might be running. I'm not sure it's running well, and I would hope that he'll be on his way, or will be able to make his way back to the pits, because clearly the laptop's lied.
Yeah. Now it looks like he's struggling for full throttle or something.
Yeah. Yeah. On board with Nicky Katzberg again. This is the final chicane. Pit exit is on your left there. So that's why that chicane is there, much the same as we had the street circuit in Porto, to guard the pit lane exit so you don't come flying out into somebody doing 250 kilometres an hour. Just a little breath on the throttle there through turn 4, 5. So you climb a little bit here and then into this braking area. Round the roundabout the wrong way. Watching him here now out of corner 6. This is 7. And again, look, barrier to barrier, Harry. This is, you know, using all the road, all the curbs. There's not going to be any problems with exceeding track limits here.
No, definitely not. You have to make every little bit count, and I'm pretty sure we'll see some wing mirrors flying before the end of qualifying, at least.
This is a quick lap from Katzberg. No better than the previous ones. Jimmy T has just gone a little bit quicker. Now, he didn't race here last year, so this is his first experience of the circuit. And again, even a driver with James Thompson's experience, you have to bear in mind, don't you, that you need to build up speed. It's very easy to go, yeah, I've got this, and then not have it, and suddenly there's no car for the weekend. And that would be absolutely the worst of all outcomes.
Yeah, it's also the cardinal sin, like you say, to lob the car in free practice when you've been given an opportunity to decorate the sponsors' logos around Villarreal for the weekend, and then you stick it in the wall in free practice or qualifying, then that wouldn't go down too well.
Not at all. And don't forget that this car and this driver were in very good form in our last street race in Morocco, even though it was wet. Jimmy T should have won the first race, got thumped up the backside in turn 2 or 3, wherever it was, and as a result didn't even finish the first lap, but definitely has potential here to have a very good run. And I would think Tom Coronel will be thinking very much the same thing at the moment. Coronel's Chevy is in 11th place. And as you said, the Chevrolet was always a good street fighter, still is. No question, that car has not forgotten how to get around streets.
Yeah, definitely. It's something that, you know, the great mighty RML have learned over the years. They've done a lot of street racing, and they've worked out how to adapt that car from something which is fantastic on Grand Prix style circuits to something which works around tight and twisty stuff as well.
Yeah. Thiago on a purple second sector after a green first sector. There's his dad on the left with William de Brecolaire, the head of the Honda program here, head of Honda Motorsport Europe.
Montero, Lopez and Huff have all just gone back out, so I'm guessing they're probably all on fairly fresh rubber. I mean, that was only a tenth down Montero, 1/10 down on Michelin, so...
He was 7,000ths behind, so it wasn't even a tenth of a tenth. 7/10 of a tenth of a tenth.
Yeah.
So, yeah, very close indeed. And again, you know, that's sort of faintly ridiculous. Where it was, it's 4.7 kilometres, so 3. Whatever miles, and you get two cars, well, ostensibly identical, but they never are identical because drivers want different things, driven by two different drivers. Look at the way the camera's moving around. Look at the way Lopez's arms are moving around. On a street circuit like this, where you're constantly moving around, and they're 7/1000ths of a second difference. I mean, that's just almost impossible to conceive that you can be that close to somebody.
Look at Huffy as well, 35,000ths down on Montero. So that shows those three Hondas are all very evenly matched. And as you were saying, Martin, you know, they're pretty much, they're going to be all on an identical pace, basically. It's going to be who wins qualifying, I think.
Yes, the three Hondas, first, second and third, covered by 35,000ths of a second. And yeah, I mean, faintly ridiculous that they could be so close. Lopez fourth, Valente fifth, Ted Bjerk sixth. So you got three Hondas and then one of each of their rivals, a Citroën, a Lada and a Volvo. Ooh, and Philippi didn't have enough room to get over to drivers left, did he, there, to get out of Ivan's way. And so Ivan had to sort of squeeze up the middle. And Philippi on the dirt there, I think, was probably very conscious about not over-braking, locking up and just flying all over the place.
Yes,
okay, so Nadja is back in the pit lane. Again, apologies to our Hungarian listeners if I'm mangling his name. I'm going with Daniel, since I'm fairly confident I can manage that. I gather Nadja is as close as I'm going to get without actually being Hungarian. So here's Ivan Muller, currently lies seventh. This is a personal best lap he's just completed. Gets down to 2 minutes, 0.095. His fastest lap, a 1.59.5. The fastest lap, a 1.57.3. So again, are we going to have to try and explain to the audience why some of the Citroëns are 2 seconds off the pace? Well, we've sort of alluded to it or explained it already, haven't we, that this track does not suit the car. That's just all there is to it, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic. That's one of the beauty of touring car racing, is that you have different cars are better at different elements of the racing that they're designed to do, so it makes it exciting.
Yes. If we were just going to long, fast Grand Prix circuits, then the Citroën would be fastest everywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, when we get to Shanghai, you won't see them for dust. In fact, frankly, actually, when we get to Argentina, you're not going to see them either, because that is a quick circuit as well. The tight bits aren't, but there's enough quick stuff there, and that long back straight, that's absolutely their trump card.
They're carrying a lot of weight as well, which will be a big factor around the street circuit. You know, a lot of starting and stopping around here, and yes, it's fast, but there are some big stops as well and some big traction zones as well where it'll really hurt them.
And again, no points for free practice one, no points for free practice two. You don't get anything for your weekend until you actually perform in qualifying and then into the race. Norbert Michelitz showing purple again, a fastest second sector of anyone.
I was going to say, somebody needs to tell the Honda boys that.
He is fully lit up. Well, they've got 60 kilos of success ballast, which I'm sure is what the car was designed around, because that was previously the maximum, and you sort of had to assume that if you had a car that was in any way going to be competitive at some stage, it would, or most of its life, it would spend with maximum success ballast.
2/10 up.
Wow. That's a big lap. So the first sector wasn't even better than his previous best, but sector two and sector three were. So we now actually have some clear air between Norby and then Thiago and Rob. Thiago and Rob, their best laps still only 28,000ths of a second apart. Behind them, Lopez and Muller now fourth and fifth. We're probably not going to have to explain why the Citroëns are so far off the pace, although they are 1.2 and 1.4 behind. That gap will come down. Ugo Valente sixth, Velada, seventh, Mehdi Benani in a Citroën, eighth now, Ted Bjerk, ninth, Nicky Katzberg, tenth, Tom Chilton. So let's look around, sort of extrapolate this a little bit towards qualifying. We could, as we saw in Russia, see a 1-2-3 qualifying sweep. In Russia, it was the Ladas. Not only their first ever pole, after they were denied in Slovakia by some mimsing, but a 1-2-3 in qualifying, which was just a staggering result. But we could see that from the Hondas here. We could see the Hondas go 1-2-3 in qualifying. That's certainly not beyond the bounds of possibility, even remotely.
Yeah, I think that we know that they've got the pace to be 1-2-3. It's whether Honda will play the game of trying to position somebody a little bit lower down the grid for race two.
No. They all need driver's points. They all need driver's points. And you'll try and survive race one to get into race two. Nicky Katzberg's looped it round at the roundabout. Waved on.
Well, that was close.
Yep, that was close. You come down there, and the roundabout right, you're sort of aiming down the middle of that little fork of in the road, and you either go left into the pit lane or right, but you can't leave it more than a fraction of a second to make that call, because otherwise you're not going anywhere. You are going to hit it head on, and that's not moving.
No, that looks like you're in somebody's office, actually, if you hit that hard.
Yeah. That's Ferenc Fischer, who is 16th in the Zengo Motorsport Honda that didn't have an engine issue. Daniel Adge actually has left the pits again, so they are really desperate to try and get that car to work properly.
Huffy's on a lap again.
Yeah, Huffy is on a hot lap as well.
Yeah.
No yellows down here. And he goes fastest of all by a quarter of a second. Wow, 156.9. So we started the morning with 202s and 203s, and we're now 6 seconds quicker.
Yeah, that was obviously a big lap again from Rob at the end there. But
yeah, they'll have worked up a sweat doing that, won't they?
Yeah, definitely. Huffy and Michelitz have always been street fighters, haven't they? They've always done well on street circuits, so I think my bet would be on one of those two guys being on the pole, and obviously Montero's right there with them as well. You know, there's really not a lot of calling between those three, but I'm guessing we're going to see a fairly Honda-dominated weekend.
It could well be. Now, getting by here is not going to be as easy, maybe, as it would be on another circuit. So starting 10th, 9th and 8th on the opening race grid, you're not going to get maybe a lot of points out of it. But then the flip side to that is if you do survive, you'll be 1, 2, 3 on the main race grid. That's a good place to start. So Rob Huff ends up fastest in first free practice. So down towards the bottom of the top 10. So from sort of Ted Bjerk in seventh down to, I guess, Robert Darga and James Thompson in 14th. You've got, you know, half the field there that will be in and around 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th in qualifying. And that 10th position, which will give you the pole for the opening race, that's obviously the golden ticket. They're not going to compete with the Honda boys on pace. But what they might be looking to do is start the opening race of the weekend at the sharp end of the grid. Has Tom Coronel gone dead stick? I think he's lost the engine. He's waving.
No, I think he's locked up. If you look just behind him, there's two big black lines. I think he's locked up and perhaps stalled, and maybe it won't start again.
Yeah. Well, I don't think he's got an engine. He wouldn't be waving. He'd just be driving on. No, they're not his black lines.
No, you're right. He's actually just broken down, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Right in front of the black lines. They're already there.
That is either... Well, either the car's gone into some sort of get-you-home mode and switched itself off, or it's run out of fuel, which is also a possibility.
It's done again.
Seems unlikely. Yeah, Pietro there, his engineer, is... Yeah, engineers tend to be quite attentive to detail, don't they, H?
Yes, yeah.
But... they are only human beings.
Yeah, running out of fuel is probably there. Not, it'd be a bit lower down the list of things, I think. But you're right, it's entirely possible people do make mistakes. And sometimes it can happen, you know, if the Bowser, the way the fuel in and out with has an issue. And, you know, it's red that they've weighed the correct amount in, but it actually has gone, you know, a kilo less.
Yep. There's Norby. They are looking a bit warm, aren't they? It's fairly warm in the cars. It's temperatures must be 24 outside, maybe. And inside the car, much more like 34, getting up towards 40 degrees, probably. Lots of fans on the fronts of the cars, latched on to blow all the leaf blowers blowing air through the engine to replace the moving air that keeps everything cool. And that, of course, is because the massive heat that the turbos generate doesn't dissipate instantly you turn them off. So you've got to keep the air going through the cooling system, through the all the ducting through the engine that is there specifically for that to cool. There is Gergely, who is now engineering Tiago, having moved across at the same time as Norby last year and engineered Norby for the last few years. He's not engineering Norby. They've sort of moved the team around a little bit.
It's interesting because Tiago seems to have found a bit of pace, I think, this year over previous years. So perhaps that's Gergely's influence. And
well, and last year he sort of seemed to finally have some good luck, didn't he? You know, he was always, particularly with him and Gabrielli, if there was ever anybody that the bad luck fairy was going to come and find, it was always number 18. It was always Tiago. And then last year, He just started to have good form. He's always had good pace, but then it sort of translated into results, and that seems to have continued, as you say, yeah.
And I wonder how much of it, you know, maybe previously that when Thiago was teammate with Gabrielli, perhaps Gabrielli had quite a lot of influence in how the car was set up, and that might not necessarily have suited, you know, maybe he's leading the setup direction a little bit.
I think it might be a little bit more of an open house format. I think you're exactly right. Gabrielli definitely did lead, yes, in the previous seasons. Well, let's hear from Rob Huff.
Well, very nicely done. Go hard or go home, eh? What's it like out there?
I mean, it was really slippery at the beginning of the session. A lot of dust, a lot of dirt. And the track was just getting quicker and quicker every lap. And I think basically whoever crossed the line last was probably going to be quickest. And that was me, I think. So car feels good. You know, we're working on the setup. But a condition like that is so difficult to actually tell anything about the car. But, we've got to be happy with that.
Very nice start. Thiago, home ground. What's it like for you out there? It actually looks like the three of you are kind of vying for top spot at the moment. The Hondas are obviously very close here.
Yeah, the Hondas are close. Of course, they seem competitive. We seem competitive since yesterday already. But as Rob said, I mean, you have to go out there and push and get the grip of the track because it's cleaning up every lap. It's getting stronger, faster and faster every lap. And ideally, you'll be the last one to cross the line and especially push hard without making any mistakes. It's a big challenge out there, but I'm enjoying it so far.
And hoping for a better result than last year?
Well, definitely. Hopefully, especially a better start. so far it's going well. Off the walls, fingers crossed. We hope to keep it like this. The crowds have been amazing. Every time I go by, they're all cheering up and standing up. It's fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Thiago.
Well, he definitely does have massive support here. Lots and lots of banners hanging off the buildings around the circuit. And he, you know, former Grand Prix driver and a big touring car star. He is a big name here and really brings the fans in.